Simon & Schuster Audio presents Disconnected by Jennifer Weiner. Read by Jess Weixler.
Get a new phone number, they had told her, along with go to a meeting your first day out. And do 90 and 90. And find a sponsor. And find a home group. And the only thing you have to change is everything. Feeling as fragile and skinless as a peeled egg, Shannon vowed that this time she'd follow directions. She was almost 30 years old, hardly a kid anymore. And she'd been in and out of rehab 6 times already. Not that anyone was counting. It was getting old. Besides, this last time she'd almost died. They'd Narcanned her in the hospital. She'd come swimming back to consciousness, surging up and out of the darkness with tubes up her nose, a needle buried in the crook of her elbow, and a terrified nurse leaning over her saying, "God, we almost lost you." "I'm done," Shannon had decided, lying on the narrow gurney in the ER while a homeless man vomited in the corner and 2 cops stood guard over a bloodied woman handcuffed to her bed. "I am really and truly done." By then, she had lost her dignity, her money, her job as an editorial assistant at Paragon Press. For the past 3 years, she had supported herself writing blog posts for a site called Busted that had started its life as an aggregator of celebrity mugshots. Now, Shannon, who'd studied with Jane Smiley in graduate school, who'd once received a semi-encouraging rejection letter from The New Yorker, "This isn't quite right for us, but please try again," spent her days scanning electronic police department databases for the faces of the famous, the formerly famous, the almost famous, and the reality TV famous, as well as scribbling snarky comments across the thighs and torsos of actors and singers who'd gained weight and then had the temerity to appear in public in spite of it. 10 posts a day netted her $500 a week. She'd given up her apartment, the few pieces of non-IKEA furniture that she'd acquired. Busted did not offer its employees health insurance, which meant that the hospital was eager to see her backside. After they'd moved her to a room, another nurse had come in with a rape kit. She and Shannon had had a quiet conversation, and then the nurse had left with the kit, still sealed in plastic, in her hands. What had happened to her wasn't rape, Shannon had decided. It can't be rape if they pay you when it's over. From the hospital, she'd gone back into an overwarm October night and thence to rehab. A low-end one. A place where they sent people on welfare who had no money to go anyplace better. After 28 days, she'd taken the Chinatown bus to Manhattan, then the subway to Brooklyn. There was a 10:30 meeting in the basement of St. Patrick's in Bay Ridge. She went there because she knew there was a T-Mobile store just down the street. And also that the meeting, which she'd found when she'd gone to meetings the year before, often had donuts or cookies. Important if you had little money and no food. When she was sober, Shannon found that she was hungry all the time. Craving processed flour and white sugar, big mouthfuls of cheap, sweet stuff, food that could fill you and hold you in place like an anchor. She arrived while the 2 dozen attendees were mumbling through the preamble, and dumped powdered creamer and sugar into a cup of coffee until she'd created what looked like a latte. There were cinnamon-dusted donuts, and she stuffed 2 into her pockets and devoured a 3rd before taking a seat in a folding chair toward the back of the room. It was a speaker meeting. The woman behind the podium, a trembling 60-something with short brown hair and orthopedic sneakers, with white laces tied in neat bows, told the story about how she'd been hooked on Vicodin. When her doctor wouldn't renew her prescription, she began buying pills from a neighbor. Her habit had crept slowly from taking a pill a day to taking pills all day, every day, until she had slept through the pickup at her granddaughter's preschool. That, she said, was her rock bottom. That was when she decided to get help. Shannon licked cinnamon off her fingers while the woman dug tissues out of her bag. She wondered what would happen if she told them the things that she'd done, the things that had been done to her. There was a line she'd read in a book somewhere about how if a woman told the truth about her life, the world would crack open. She wasn't sure about the world, but she suspected that such truth-telling could prove mightily disruptive at an AA meeting. She was thinking about getting another donut when she saw a man with a spider web tattooed on his neck, squinting through the dusty church light like he wasn't quite sure he was seeing her or not. Shannon didn't recognize him, but that meant nothing. He could have been someone she'd dated, or someone she'd fucked for drugs, or maybe even someone she had known in college, the good old days when she'd been young and bright and full of promise, when her short stories had won prizes, when drugs were just something that appeared or did not appear at a party on a Saturday night. She dropped a dollar in the basket for the seventh tradition, and when she turned, she was unsurprised to see the spiderweb guy sitting next to her. "You knew?" he whispered. Shannon considered the question. New to the program? New to this meeting? Of course, big surprise, the guy didn't want to hear her story. He wanted to tell her his own, which was a variation on every junkie story that she'd heard. Shannon tuned it out as the guy recited the particulars. "And then he's like, 'You aren't gonna believe this stuff.' And I was all, 'Hey, wasn't this on the news last week? Aren't people dying from it?' It was fucked up, I know, but all I thought was, 'Okay, this is gonna be super strong, so I'm gonna get super high.' And the next thing you know..." He pursed his lips, an endearing little boyish gesture, and made a popping sound. "Next thing you know, you're like, flatlining in the ambulance." Shannon gave him a distracted smile. "Yeah, they Narcanned me," she said. The guy tipped an imaginary hat. "Respect," he said. Shannon smiled and tried not to think about how she'd once gotten an...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.